Do you define seeds? Let me welcome you. Thank you so much for choosing FMoPA for your Friday evening program. Let me start with some heartfelt thank yous. I'll shortly keep it short, but I can. I just want to say that we receive huge support from the community, and our biggest supporters are Hillsborough Arts Council and City of Tampa. And we also appreciate the support of local families, Jim and Celia Kerman, Brian Baldwin and Eric Hall, and Lisa and Charles Lyman are our biggest supporter for this year. We also receive a media coverage year-round from Creative Loving and many other supporters who donate their time and money to our efforts. This night is sponsored by Steve and Marty Sears, so please give an applause for the great food and wine. Thank you, Marty, very much. I think that most of us are already friendly, but for those who didn't meet me, my name is Laura Carrier, and I am an executive director at the Florida Museum of Photographic Arts. I just want to express gratitude to the team who works here, because everything at the museum is a teamwork. So maybe I can mention Anna Castellano, who is our exhibition manager. I believe that she's now running downstairs visitor service. And then let me introduce Sandra Collett, who is our education and outreach manager. But I also want to point out the work of our volunteers. Jim Miller is a wonderful help with helping us with guided tours. I want to mention another volunteers who are helping us with promotion and marketing. There are volunteers who are preparing a portfolio review for our members in April. We will announce that soon. And we have a lot of volunteers who are now supporting our book club that take off big time. And in March 10th, we will start our film club. And so all these wonderful volunteers, all these hours, and all the know-how they donated, I really want to thank them. And the museum is running with support of our wonderful board members and trustees, and so I want to thank them for the year-round support and hard work, and I think that we can applaud them again for that. Now I have a privilege to welcome Dr. MacKay at FMoPA. Dr. MacKay is a historian with a nationwide reputation for collecting and preserving our cultural heritage. He published several books in his field, and he is often invited by institutions for public speaking and participating in panel discussions. We are very fortunate to receive from Dr. MacKay donations of cirkut camera images, and this is going on for the last decade. This wonderful collaboration helped us to curate this exhibition, mostly from our permanent collection, but we also curated from some local collectors. I just want to mention and thank to Mr. and Mrs. Bradkin for this contribution. And now let me just welcome with applause Dr. MacKay.
Said this was 10 years in the making, I think, to do a show here, and it started with a call from Charles Levin, and the person who really made it happen was Zora. She's the greatest museum director in the land, I think. And she has done a wonderful job putting together the and we're lucky to have her. That's what I feel. I am a collector of images, and yet tonight I'm going to talk about the cirkut camera. So let me say that I've never taken a picture with a cirkut camera, but I have studied the work of some friends. One is a photo process engineer on Long Island, and another a professional photographer whose father was a mechanic, and these guys are masters, and so everything tonight in my book I learned from them. And we'll start with the first slide in just a minute. But when you go through the exhibit, what I think you
Sir,
will take away...
we can't hear back here.
You can't hear?
No.
Okay.
Thank you.
Is that better?
Much
okay.
better. Thank you.
What you should... what we'll take away is the remarkable resolution, the remarkable detail of these photographs. And that's because the negatives were as big as the photographs that you're looking at. They were contact printed. You can see in the various convention shots in the military pictures, every face. This was really important to the professional photographers who use this camera, because if you were doing a army regiment and a guy couldn't see his face, he wasn't likely to buy one of these pictures for a buck afterwards. So with that, we'll get started. So photography was really something that was confined to studios and to professionals up until George Eastman and the invention at the end of the 1880s of celluloid film. And boy, was that a revolution. That, of course, sparked popular photography and, you know, led to all those cameras that culminated in maybe the Brownie, and everyone could participate in this wonderful new technology of photography. That was great for most Americans, but not for the professionals who had made their living through this kind of studio work. They were in deep trouble at the end of the 19th century. It is sort of a distant mirror on what is going on today when we see all these new technologies really doing in the whole camera industry. To meet that challenge, many of these professional photographers went into specialized work, banquet photography. Here you see Darius Kinsey, a photographer early in the 20th century, pictured here about 1910 in Seattle. And he has various sorts of banquet cameras in front of his car. And the message is clear, you know, he'll travel and he'll go to your convention, he'll go to your wedding, whatever, and look at some of the equipment he has, particularly that banquet camera on the incredible high tripod. Imagine trying to use that thing. It looks like he has a cirkut in the foreground, just to his left, but a lot of equipment, still a struggle to make a living as a professional photographer. So a great breakthrough in cameras at this point was introduced by the Rochester Camera Company, and it was called the cirkut camera. And this camera was powered by a single spring. You wound it up, and it did two things. It rotated the camera on a round plate as the film rotated in the opposite direction between two great reels at the back of the camera. So this was a shutterless camera. It was known as a slit scan camera, and the film was exposed as it passed this slit. And the camera was controlled by a governor. It could only rotate at a certain speed. And here we see probably the most popular circuit. There were eventually five different circuit cameras. Here is the number 10, which came with three convertible lenses. And you could take 360-degree pictures. This was a camera that literally ran in circles and really addressed that need to see ever wider. It's a need that is coming right out of the late 18th century with the beginning of photographic panoramas. And we see it in the cyclorama buildings at the middle of the 19th century. We paid to go into these exhibits of painted scenes that would go right around a building. Pilgrims landing from the Mayflower, this kind of thing. And this camera, the cirkut, was introduced in 1905. And that very year, the company is bought by Kodak. Kodak was sort of like Cisco today, or maybe Microsoft, out buying up every new idea that came along. And it joins the Kodak family. The Kodak owned Century Camera Company, and then various divisions of Kodak, and it's produced right up until, at least the number 10, until 1949. That was the final year of production for any circuit camera. And over here to my left are some text panels. You'll see some of the cameras that came along right after to replace the circuit, like the round shot and the wide lux and whatnot. And now even those cameras are largely history. So innovation moving quickly. So Kodak, seeing this market, seeing this opportunity to sell this new camera to those professionals who were looking for new ways to make their business work, had a series of ads that told everyone just how easy it was to use these cameras. If you knew how easy it is to make and sell circuit pictures, you would see your dealer about buying a circuit today. Of course, they were anything but easy to use. First of all, the first problem that you ran into with a circuit, it was cylindrical distortion. Now here we have a picture of the crew of the USS Birmingham arriving in Boston right after the First World War, and they're lined up in a straight line in front of their ship. But look what happens. The line is bent, and even the ship is distorted in the background. It took anything that was straight in a line, and it twisted it. So what you had to do as a photographer was to compensate. And the only way to do that was with the cooperation of your audience. And so here we see a photograph being taken in Bellingham, Washington. It's a Grand Army of the Republic reunion up there in 1914. And all the veterans are, as you can see, in a semicircle. And the guy, the guy off to the left, or maybe it's the guy to the right, may well be the photographer arranging his subjects in this arc. These pictures of the circuit photographers working their art, arranging their subjects, are really rare. This is really quite a wonderful image. Here's another one, also from out in the Northwest. And here, he's got even a bigger problem. He's got vehicles. And so you see the cars in the usual crescent. And that almost surely is the photographer right in the middle there. His camera, you'll see over to the left by the wall. And he's just about ready to take his photograph. Sometimes it was particularly difficult, as it was, I think, for Mr. Schultz, who was doing the Fox roller skating girls one day in 1929 in Washington, D.C. And you see Schultz has put a chalk line down on the street. These girls could easily have skated away, and he wanted to make sure they stayed on the line. Next problem was the speed. Since this camera is rotating slowly with its governor, anything moving faster than the camera would cause a blur. So what we have here in the upper photo, we have a circuit image of Churchill Downs, and you can see how it bends the grandstand at Churchill Downs. In the lower one, you've got the Indianapolis 500 in 1913. And to get this image, the photographer very wisely got way downwind from the start. And those cars are moving, but they haven't streaked yet. And he got a pretty good image here. Now, certainly wasn't 180 degrees, but it still worked. Probably the most famous photographer, commercial photographer, to use circuit cameras was E.O. Goldbeck from San Antonio, Texas. And Goldbeck was one of the first to deal with another problem this camera had, and that is when you needed to shoot down, there was no way to do that unless you prop books under the rear legs of the tripod. So he invents this patented wedge plate, which you're seeing right under the camera. It's above the tripod, above the base, and under the camera. Looks like a V there. And that was particularly useful when you were at any kind of elevation and taking a picture of a convention or a military unit. This was the life of a typical circuit camera photographer. Lots of your work was going to be on the road. Goldbeck was famous for traveling all over the country to photograph conventions and military units. He was well known at every Army fort west of the Mississippi, and actually some of his employees got east of the Mississippi. There's some wonderful pictures of Mitchell Field on Long Island that he did. You see all of his equipment strapped to his car, and off he went, and you kind of wonder how did they do it all. I mean, once he took a picture at Fort Riley, Kansas, he had to develop those pictures and have enough available to sell for a dollar or two to the soldiers. And apparently these guys often used bathtubs in their hotel rooms to wash the photos, and light bulb arrangements to print with, and this kind of thing. Then when you got there, to get every face, you needed that elevation. So the towers were truly amazing. Now in the upper right, we see a guy who looks like he's standing on top of a barn, you know, and a ventilator on top of a barn. And then just below him is someone really taking a chance. He's on top of a telephone pole. And off to the left, the picture probably from the 1940s, you have a big stationary tower, but you also have a truck with a mobile tower, you know, whatever it took. And I think the record tower was something like 212 feet, built by Goldbeck after the war to take a picture of a unit. So the camera comes in different sizes. There's the No. 6, the No. 8, the No. 10, and the No. 16. What the numbers indicated was the width of the film. Now, with the No. 16, the film was 16 inches high, but you could take 24-foot long photographs with the No. 16, and there was that much in a roll of No. 16 film. And with a bigger, if you had the No. 16, you could also use the film made for the 10-inch camera, for the 8-inch, and so forth. Excuse me. Yes, the film was expensive. The John A. Dick was a in-house photographer for DuPont, and you see him standing next to the massive No. 16. Now that camera would have weighed, like the No. 10 weighed about 50 pounds. That camera probably was close to 100 pounds, so dragging that thing around. And he found it ideal for construction progress photos. You know, the DuPont plant would be being built and they would want them back in Wilmington. They'd want pictures every week of the progress of the construction, and this was a very effective way to do it. And you see the prices there. Now this would be about 1910, 112 up to 425, I believe it is, for the No. 16. And this is what the film looked like. It came in metal cartridges rolled up, and then in the cardboard boxes, specially marked for circuit film. And there's in the exhibit, Zora has a example of film in a box. And this is obviously an exposed piece of film. Here's Goldbeck later in life, and luckily they were able to record what he did in his San Antonio shop. He is probably in his 80s when this is being taken, maybe older. And there in the upper left, you see his printing device, and those little round bumps by his knee, those are the light bulbs for the use for the developing. And then in the larger picture, he is preparing one of his cedar lined tubs to wash the that was attached to the 101st Cavalry. And they're up at on their 2-week summer bivouac up in upstate New York in 1937. And the guy holding the flag was my father-in-law. and his brother-in-law is also in this picture. It is a very long photograph, and of course, very hard to get to talk about these circuits in this fashion, because you can't get the whole picture up on the screen very well. But I cut some corners here, And you can see the whole picture in my book. But just to orient you, there's my father-in-law with a flag. And then what you're seeing are the ends of this long picture to the right. So a guy called Walter Devereux, with a cigar in his mouth, runs behind the cameraman and gets to the other side of the formation in time to be photographed twice. And these are called double enders. And if you're a circuit image collector, you love these. You look for double enders. There's a good double ender in here of the Larkin, of an outing that the Larkin Soap Company employees were on at Niagara Falls back before World War II. And there, often it's just one guy, but sometimes you see two or three guys. And I've seen one picture of a class at RIT. I think it was the class of a man called Brem, who helped to further perfect the circuit camera. His picture is over here against the wall. And the entire class appears twice in the picture. They're sitting on a grandstand, and they all got around, beat the governor, and appeared twice. So, if you're interested in collecting these, look for the unusual. I'm afraid that Mr. Schultz and Mr. Goldbeck just took too many military units. They're the ones you're going to encounter most often. But more prized are the unusual. If it's a beauty contest on a boardwalk in Atlantic City or Pasadena or something like that, they're really worth having. This was a picture of a twins convention in Grand Rapids in the 1940s. Twins and multiples. I guess multiples are where you actually have three siblings or four siblings even that look alike. And it's a wonderful image. Very nice too are scenic views. They were popular, and also popular were pictures of disasters. There was no CNN to see what happened today, so the photographs of tragedies were apparently quite marketable because they're so many that seem to survive. Here we have one of the USS Shenandoah, one of this great airship. The government had three big airships in the 20s, all built because the Germans in World War I had really made advances in the dirigible area. And this one came down in 1925 in an electrical storm over Ohio. And there is another image, a different image of this wreck in the exhibit tonight. When you see photographs like this or copies of photographs that have the line down the center, that means that it's a Library of Congress picture. Apparently, the Library of Congress didn't have books big enough to put these pictures in, so they cut them in half. And the photographers sending in pictures for copyright, as they often did, would get them recorded, but the picture was always in two parts after the government staff got to it. And another Library of Congress view of a flood in, somewhere in the Midwest. I think there's some floods in the exhibit tonight as well. And by the, toward the end of the circuit era, and it you know, it's amazing how long these cameras were in use, really, and they had become quite popular by 1910. They probably were around in some form even in the late 1890s. And then the Rochester Camera Company is developing them in the early aughts. And they're being used, I mean, as we said, the Cirkut 10, the last one to be produced, all the way up to 1949. But they were still in use in the 1950s and 60s. And I bet some people here today had graduation pictures that were taken by a Cirkut in the 1960s. Trying to make them even more popular was something called the Cirkut outfit, which comes along between the wars. And here Kodak is thinking, well, you know, maybe we can sell more of these cameras if the Cirkut could do more. So, you know, the Cirkut outfit would allow you to use the camera for panoramas as a Cirkut, but you could also take the suitcase off the back with the film cartridges and use it as a conventional camera. They don't seem to have been as popular as the regular Cirkuts. But this brings us to an end of the slideshow here, I'll stop now, and I think Zora, we can put the lights on, and if there are questions, we'll try to answer them.
Of Dr. MacKay. Thank you very much and have a beautiful and safe night.
Thank you all.